Welcome to the session on dividing a nation, the origins of the secession crisis and civil war. My name is Michael Holt. I'm from the University of Virginia. Before we get into the planned presentations, however, my friend Peter Colchin, who's a co-chair of the program committee, has a brief announcement he'd like to make to you.
Thank you, Mike. It's good to see you all here. As a co-chair of the 2011 Program Committee, and on behalf of the Organization of American Historians, I want to welcome you to what promises, I think, to be a very exciting plenary session, Dividing a Nation, and also to announce that this session marks the launching of the OAH's five-year project to commemorate the sesquicentennial of the American Civil War. From 2011, which is now, 2015, the OAH Civil War at 150 project will bring the best current thinking on this complex era to a wide audience, in keeping with our mission to promote excellence in scholarship, teaching, and presentation of all American history. We will explore the war from its beginnings through its aftermath, especially mindful of the needs of history teachers and students, the challenges faced by public historians, and the curiosity of the general public. In publications, at our conferences, with our speakers, and through our online projects, the OAH will focus on the following broad themes during the successive sesquicentennial years. In 2011, origins. In 2012, mobilizing for war. In 2013, turning points. In 2014, the total war. And in 2015, legacies, including the war's most important legacy, the emancipation of almost 4 million African-American slaves. For more information on this important project, the Civil War at 150, you can visit the OAH website, www.oah.org. And that's it. I promised a minute and a half, and I think I stuck to that.
Well,
so now it's Mike's turn.
Okay, I'd like to explain our ground rules for a minute before we get started. We are going to have each of the panel members talk for about 15 minutes individually up here from this microphone. Then I'm going to allow time for discussion among them when we'll be sitting at the table there, and then we'll throw it open to the audience for questions. We are being filmed by C-SPAN. I've got the schedule. It's going to be run this Saturday at three different times on C-SPAN. So if you want to ask a question, please come up behind one of the microphones to ask your question so it can be recorded for their show. We're going to shuffle the order of speakers slightly from what was listed in your programs, but very slightly, since each speaker is only going to go for 15 minutes. Individually, and I thought I'd introduce our speakers all now before we get started in the order in which they are going to speak. Leading off will be Bruce Levine, who took his BA at Michigan and his PhD from the University of Rochester. He is now the James G. Randall Distinguished Professor of History and Professor of African American Studies at the University of Illinois, Champaign-Urbana. He is the author of four books, including Confederate Emancipation, Southern Plans to Free and Arm Slaves During the Civil War, and I suppose more relevant to this session, Half Slave and Half Free, The Roots of the Civil War. He is currently at work on a fifth book under contract to Random House to be entitled The Fall of the House of Dixie, The Confederacy's Defeat and slavery's destruction. I said people can read his book to answer this one question you mentioned. Following Bruce will be Elizabeth Varon, who took her BA at Swarthmore College and her PhD at Yale. She has taught at Wellesley College and Temple, and this past fall she joined us in the history department at the University of Virginia. Aside here, had the organization known when this panel was put together that Liz would be coming to Virginia, I'd probably be at home watching the basketball tournament right now. I don't think I'd be asked to chair this session with a colleague on it, but I'm not a commentator, I'm just a timekeeper, the way I see it. Anyway, she has written two prize-winning books, but I think it's her third and most recent book, Disunion, The Coming of the American Civil War, 1789 to 1859, that is probably most relevant to our discussion today. And she's currently at work on another book about the meaning of Appomattox to generations of Americans at the time and later, that's under contract to Oxford Press. The third speaker, Marc Egnal, put this session together. Certainly he's the one that recruited me to be chair. He too got his BA from Swarthmore College, and then he took his PhD from the University of Wisconsin. He spent most of his career at York University in Toronto, Canada, where he's now a professor of history. He has written four books on a very wide range of topics. I think of anyone on this stage, he clearly has the greatest, certainly chronological range to his publications. His first book, A Mighty Empire, was on the origins of the American Revolution, and his third book was on the American colonies in early Canada prior to the American Revolution, but it's his fourth book that's most relevant to our current our discussion today, and that is Clash of Extremes, The Economic Origins of the Civil War, and without further ado, I'll let Bruce get us started.
Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for coming to our panel, and thank you, Michael, for that introduction. Any explanation of the war's causes must answer at least two questions. The first, why did the South secede? And the second, why did the North resist secession? 150 years ago this month, Abraham Lincoln clarified the issue that brought on the secession in his first inaugural address. As he said, quote, "One section of our country believes slavery is right and ought to be extended, while the other believes it is wrong and ought not to be extended. This," he said, "is the only substantial dispute," end quote. And Lincoln was here identifying the central fact that led to secession and ultimately the war, the geographical division of the United States into two distinct, albeit interrelated, forms of society, one based on slave labor predominantly and one based on free labor. And these two forms of social order grew increasingly uncomfortable with one another in the same federal union. But the implicit conflict between North and South was refracted through the values, assumptions, and perceived vital interests of specific social classes within each section. So for the sectional dispute to produce war required the presence of at least these following historical elements. First, a slave class longing for freedom. Second, a slave-owning class and its planter leadership, determined to preserve its position, its wealth, and its power, while increasingly anxious about its position within the Union. And third, a northern middle class, large sections of which grew first increasingly critical of slavery, second, especially unhappy with slave owners' power over the nation as a whole, but also third, strongly attached to the Federal Union as a guarantor of its own values, interests, and rights. These three factors gave rise to a spiraling conflict between free and slave states during the pre-war years. Those who dominated political life in the antebellum South were slaveholders in their great majority. They considered slavery essential to their prosperity, their happiness, their way of life. Only slave labor, the South's economic and political elite believed, could cultivate its staple crops in a way that yielded the profits that they did. But the master's attachment to slavery was not simply reducible to dollars and cents, as important as those calculations undoubtedly were. Over the course of decades, many of these masters had come to regard slavery as the essential basis of any good society, for reasons that were not only economic, but also social, cultural, and political. Slavery, it seemed to them, for one thing, was the only firm foundation for republican government. More generally still, their peculiar institution was the unique basis of the particular outlook, assumptions, norms, habits, and multifarious relationships to which they had become deeply and reflexively attached, trying to persuade such people to exchange their slaves for other types of property was wasted breath. About two-thirds of the white families of the seceding states owned no slaves. The active and sustained support of many, if not most, of these families, and they were overwhelmingly families of small farmers, was crucial to the Confederacy's creation and its survival. So what explains that support? Well, some had indirect economic stake in the slave system of various kinds. And as South Carolina's last wartime governor noted, quote, men who did not own a Negro, end quote, often fought for slavery in the expectation or hope of having some eventually, end quote. Other non-slaveholding supporters of the Confederacy, however, had no obvious economic interest or expectations attached to slavery. The Confederate partisanship on their part arose from a determination to protect their states against what they viewed as outside domination. But I believe the key factor in the Southern white majority's devotion to slavery, and therefore to a slavery-devoted Confederacy, was its determination to keep black people in a firmly subordinate position. Most slaveless Southern whites believed that only slavery could guarantee the survival of white supremacy. Indeed, much of their fierce hostility to what they regarded as outsider meddling sprang from fears for the South's racial order. The slavery that stood at the center of Southern society was an institution that required maintaining strict control over the enslaved black laborer. But most slaves aspired to be free, and under the right conditions, they were able and willing to seek that freedom. At some level, most masters knew that. Hence their extreme touchiness when faced with anything that threatened their control over their human property. To maintain and shore up that control, Southern communities and state legislatures strove in a multitude of ways to dominate the thoughts and further restrict the actions of the black population, free as well as slave. To keep slaves convinced that both escape and resistance was hopeless, also require that the white population be dependably and visibly united in support of black servitude and ready to enforce it. So slave owners and their allies set out to prevent the expression in the South of anti-slavery views. But as the years passed, keeping the South alone solid for slavery did not seem to be enough. They also had to curb the speech and other acts and the political power of what they perceived as wrong-thinking whites who lived in the free states. In the North as well as in the South, the particular form that economic and social development took shaped the population's cultural, intellectual, and political lives and values. It's certainly true that racism was virulent in the North as well as the South. But Northerners who embraced the free labor social order commonly came to view personal autonomy for all men and the right to own one's body as the building blocks of all good societies once again. So here's the mirror opposite image of the view of the slaveholders. This opinion grew especially pronounced among middling property owners and skilled workers, as a train of historians have shown us. The ownership of one human being by another came to appear to them not only economically backward, but also morally repugnant and politically dangerous. This view lay at the core first of abolitionism and then later the more broadly based free soilism and then eventually republicanism as well. Southern leaders, anxious about their ability to control their slaves, felt threatened by the words and actions of slavery's northern critics. They reacted by trying to purge anti-slavery pamphlets and leaflets from the mails and encouraging friends in the North to silence abolitionists in their midst. They sought above all to prevent anti-slavery northern whites from challenging their interests, and especially through the federal government. As long as possible, they banished anti-slavery petitions and speeches from the House of Representatives. Years later, they demanded and they got a new and beefed up fugitive slave law that required northern citizens to join posses chasing people accused of being escaped slaves. During the 1840s and 1850s, they strove to legalize slavery in additional territories and states, at least in part to assure and strengthen their control over the federal government. But this relentless campaign to keep the Union safe for slavery did not smother the sectional conflict. On the contrary, it escalated it. It eventually convinced most Northerners that only a political party committed to halting slavery's expansion once and for all, and to checking the national political power of slavery's champions, could protect their own rights and interests. The Republican Party came into existence to do just that. Lincoln's election to the presidency, therefore, triggered secession by those states containing the strongest concentrations of slaves. It seemed to their leaders that although the Republicans did not yet control the federal government as a whole, they would surely soon do so. And that impending national domination by the Republicans would eventually, they believed, kill slavery everywhere. Even more fundamentally, the Republican Party's swiftly growing power seemed to prove that the Northern population's views and aims were incompatible with slavery's future in the Union. In 1860-61, thus, the defense of slavery had led the states of the Lower South to strike what most Northerners, and by no means only those who are most hostile to slavery, had led the states of the Lower South to strike at what most Northerners regarded as the most serious blow against their liberty that had yet occurred. Slave power, they believed, was now trying to dissolve the Union itself, a Union which, in a world dominated by monarchies and aristocracies, seemed to be the last best hope of white men's freedoms and self-government, Republican government. Surely that could not be allowed. Virginia North Carolina, Tennessee, Arkansas had resisted secession's call until April of 1861. They had stronger business ties to the North. They feared being on the front lines of any North-South war. They contained a proportionally larger number of non-slaveholders than did the Lower South. But in the Upper South, too, unionism had been declining in strength throughout the previous decade. And when the Lower South withdrew from the Union, that further weakened the position, the power of the Upper South within the Union, and therefore reduced their attachment to the Union. So the North's decision to resist the Lower South's secession militarily was simply the last straw. The leaders of Virginia, North Carolina, Tennessee, and Arkansas chose to stand by the masters of the Cotton Kingdom in the then erupting war, principally because, as one former North Carolina Unionist put it, they believed, his words, the whipping of a slave state would mean the whipping of slavery as a whole, end quote. In sum, to secure their grip on the enslaved labor force, Southern leaders took steps that most Northern whites eventually came to regard as intolerable infringements on their own interests and rights. In response, Northern whites took steps that increased slave owners' fears that their peculiar institution was in danger. And that, I suggest, was why, as Lincoln memorably put it, the war came. Thank you.
Welcome, everybody. In a December 1860 editorial on the late election, Frederick Douglass reflected on exactly what Lincoln's victory really meant for the anti-slavery cause. The rail splitters' triumph at the polls proved, as Douglass saw it, that slaveholders were no longer the president makers of the Republic. The Northern electorate had disregarded the Democratic charge that Lincoln was a radical abolitionist, and had stood up to the Southern threat that his election would precipitate secession. As Douglass explained, quote, "Hitherto the threat of disunion has been as potent over the politicians of the North as the cat o' nine tails is over the backs of the slaves. Mr. Lincoln's election breaks this enchantment," Douglass wrote, "dispels this terrible nightmare, and awakes the nation to the consciousness of new powers and the possibility of a higher destiny than perpetual bondage to an ignoble fear," unquote. Frederick Douglass's mixed metaphors, his invocation of disunion as a whip, a spell, a nightmare, and a craven fear, signify the power and emotional resonance of this key word of antebellum politics. Disunion, I argue in my recent book, was not merely a synonym for secession. It was a much more pervasive word, and one that reverberated in our national politics and in the slavery debates long before a viable secession movement took shape. The word was so resonant because the central premise in early American political culture was that the Republic was fragile, beset by external enemies and in perpetual danger of moral decline and internal dissension. For many Americans in the North and in the South, disunion thus connoted the nightmare of civil war, imagined in dystopian terms as a tragic cataclysm that would reduce everyone in its wake to fear and misery. And yet, precisely because it was so emotionally charged, the word disunion proved irresistible as a political tool for discrediting one's opponents. Over the course of the antebellum period, Northerners and Southerners alike intimated and predicted disunion. They disparaged and disavowed it. They accused their opponents of desiring it, and they invoked it as an unfolding and inexorable process. The story of the sectional crisis is fundamentally the story of how Americans came to view slavery as the most potent of all sources of disunion, and how some of those Americans, namely the secessionists, reimagined disunion not as a cataclysm, but as the means to secure political dominance and to perpetuate the slave system. Disunion was often conjured, as in the Douglass quote with which I began, in metaphors, word pictures, and striking visual depictions to dramatize the threat that political heresy posed to the fledgling republic. This tumultuous era in our national politics had, if you will, its own distinct vernacular, a vivid, earthy, graphic, timorous, and at times humorous way of expressing political difference. My interpretation of the war's origins focuses, in short, on rhetoric and language and discourse. And rather than providing an overview of my argument, I'd like to instead highlight a few key points in order to illustrate what intellectual history as a method has to offer to our understanding of the war's causes. Writing this book, Disunion, was for me a guilty pleasure, as the field of intellectual history was my first love. And my operative definition of its methodology is a sort of straightforward one. Intellectual history I take to be the close reading of texts with attention to their context, to the ways that they speak to each other across boundaries of time and place, and to the ways that groups of texts constitute discourses bounding and delimiting debate. This method I propose promotes broad inclusiveness. Now, this may seem at first to be a counterintuitive claim, as intellectual history is still generally construed as the study of educated elites. Yet, as I tried to show in my book, implicitly at least, a history of ideas approach enables us to tune in a much wider array of voices than are to be found in standard political, economic, or even social history treatments of the war's origins. My criteria for inclusion in my book was not an individual's power or prominence or even representativeness, but rather his or her cogency, the quality of their engagement with the problem of disunion, and the depth and originality and influence of their insights. And so I feature in my interpretation the voices of fugitive slaves, Southern dissenters, free black activists, abolitionist women, and other outsiders to the halls of power. These voices, I argue, make it possible for us to better understand an essential dynamic of sectionalism. The prolonged campaign of anti-abolitionists to tarnish anti-slavery forces as disunionist. Garrisonian abolitionism threatened to breach the line that separated black from white and north from south, public from private, women's sphere from men's sphere. Northern and southern anti-abolitionists, alarmed by the movement's radical egalitarianism, sought to neutralize that threat by imputing to immediatists the treasonous fantasy of national ruin. So, for example, as abolitionists flooded Congress with anti-slavery petitions in the mid-1830s, pro-slavery politicians assailed them as madmen and madwomen who were driven by the dark desire to drive North and South and blacks and whites against each other in mortal combat. The fact that so many Northern women, black and white, signed their hands to anti-slavery petitions only served as further proof of abolition's ascribed irrationality. In other words, self-styled moderates in the sectional debates, Whig and Democrat, Northern and Southern, used disunion prophecies and accusations to cast a protective spell over slavery, to define pro-slavery unionism as the conservative mainstream position in the slavery debates. And such rhetoric, as we know, called forth waves of anti-abolition mob violence, not only in the South, but in the North too. That violence further radicalized the immediatists. When in the early 1840s, William Lloyd Garrison defiantly took up the mantle of disunion, declaring the existing union to be irredeemably accursed, he seemingly moved himself to the extreme margins of Northern politics. And it's been all too easy to dismiss Garrison's disunionism as a sort of mere rhetorical posture, a kind of self-inflicted wound. But his obdurate stance, I argue, in fact guaranteed that he and his cadre would remain at the very center of the slavery debates. From then on, the primary charge that pro-slavery forces leveled at the successive free soil political parties was that they, whatever their protestations to the contrary might be, was that they were Garrisonian disunionists in disguise. This image of Republicans as disunionists, Abraham Lincoln would lament in 1854, was the principal obstacle to the Republican Party's success. And I would argue that dispelling this charge of disunionism was a major preoccupation of Lincoln's political career, not only in the lead up to the war, but during the war itself. In short, an intellectual history approach with heightened attention to language and rhetoric and discourse prompts us to rethink who and what was central and who and what was marginal to the sectional conflict. In my interpretation, the Garrisonian abolitionists are central from start to finish. A second contribution that intellectual history can make is to enhance our sense of the contingency of events. And here again, on the face of it, this is a counterintuitive claim. a focus on discourse, how it constrains what it's possible to think and imagine can seem deterministic. And yet, as I try to show in my book, if we disentangle disunion from secession, we're better able to perceive a pattern of advance and retreat in the secessionists' long campaign to legitimize Southern nationalism. Even a self-styled centrist wielded disunion prophecies and accusations to hold this middle ground. Militant defenders of slavery pledged themselves in the 1830s to, as they put it, disarm disunion of its terrors, to imagine it for Southerners not as a fearful calamity, but instead as the prelude to the successful establishment of an independent Confederacy. The Southern Rights Vanguard, led by Robert Barnwell Rhett and James Henry Hammond of South Carolina and Edmund Ruffin and Nathaniel Beverly Tucker of Virginia, resorted to emotionally charged disunion threats to drum up resistance to immediate abolitionism. Thus, the principal protagonist, Nathaniel Beverly Tucker's fire-eating novel of 1836, The Partisan Leader, rejects what was at that time the traditional view that disunion was the maximum of evil, as he puts it, and he comes instead to believe that the anti-slavery North itself represented evil and that disunion was preferable to subjugation to the North. It was just such a conversion that men like Tucker hoped to effect in the Southern electorate. As early as the mid-1830s then, the Southern Rights Vanguard had defined for itself a mandate to disarm disunion of its terrors, to recast disunion as a positive good. So why did it take another quarter century for Southern nationalism to take shape and to materialize in a slaveholders' confederacy? A focus on language provides a new angle of vision on this fundamental question by revealing that in the 1840s and 1850s, images of disunion as a nightmare scenario, as the fruit of abolition madness, if you will, persisted in Southern politics. And not only as a favorite theme of these self-styled moderates, the pro-slavery unionists holding the middle ground, but also as a rhetorical resort for the most ardent defenders of Southern rights, including future leaders of the Confederacy. For example, when Northerners protested the Fugitive Slave Act in the early 1850s, none other than the leader of the fire eaters, Robert Barnwell Rhett, warned that Northern defiance of the federal government would, quote, crush beneath it all faith, brotherhood, and peace until the whole fabric of the Union falls a vast pile of ruin and desolation. Again, this was not mere posturing. Here's the key point. As long as there was any hope that Southern slaveholders might be able, with their Northern allies, to maintain a solid anti-abolition front, there was political capital to be had for Southerners in casting disunion as inherently uncertain and dangerous and even treasonous. Only when that front disintegrated in the mid-1850s did this pattern of advance and retreat give way to a concerted campaign by Southern rights advocates to prove that disunion under the right conditions need not be dangerous or uncertain at all. In their region's newspapers, colleges, churches, commercial conventions, literature, and other public forums, secessionists now in the mid-1850s assiduously pressed the case that if the South were divided, weak and uncertain, Republicans would be able to prosecute a war that brought all the horrors Americans had long associated with disunion, a war of chaos and massacre. But, they argued, the secessionists did, if the South were united and strong, it could quickly and decisively turn back the Northern invasion and build in the form of a new nation, an impenetrable bulwark against future aggression. Secessionists promised to those white Southerners who embraced the Confederacy, among many other bounties, a kind of linguistic clarity, an end to the long, harrowing debates over the causes and imagined consequences of disunion, and a new emphasis on the need for martial vindication. But that promise went unfulfilled. In surprising and revealing ways, disunion talk persisted during the war in the language of the opposition within each section. In other words, an intellectual history method brings to light key continuities between the pre-war and wartime periods, the politics of each. Southern unionists who had warned during the secession debates that disunion was a deep, dark vortex that would engulf the South and slavery itself found a grim vindication in the war's carnage. As Tennessee's William Brownlow put it, the war proved that disunion was a wasteful disease that would bring anarchy, lawlessness, and untold suffering to the South. In the North, too, disunion rhetoric persisted in debates over emancipation and black civil rights. Northern Democrats fumed during the war that emancipation as a war aim was just another manifestation of abolition disunionism. After Appomattox, the anti-emancipation front reconstituted itself, with conservative Northerners and Southerners together charging that the radical Republicans' agenda of black suffrage and civil rights would return the country to a state of war, that it was functionally disunionist. Only in the late 19th century did such talk of disunion fade away. For the white Northerners and Southerners who embraced reconciliation, the time for accusations was finally over. In conclusion, a focus on discourse, rhetoric, does not so much diverge from explanations rooted in self-interest as it does illuminate how people perceived and struggled to represent their interests. It's very much in our self-interest as scholars of Civil War causality to embrace, in our teaching especially, a methodological pluralism. Each historiographical approach has its own capacities and intrinsic limitations. None alone can offer a comprehensive explanation, but together they enable to recover for our students and the public the drama and complexity and agonies of the road to war. Thank you.
As the variety of sesquicentennial celebrations, including this one, make clear, few events in American history remain so important for our world today as the Civil War. This afternoon, I'd like to suggest a new approach to the causes of the conflict. It's an interpretation that shapes my recent book, Clash of Extremes. And it's this: more than any other reason, the evolution of the Northern and Southern economies explains the sectional conflict. Since this interpretation emerges from my dissatisfaction with recent interpretations, an analysis of that body of scholarship provides a necessary introduction. For the past 25 years, there's been a dominant point of view, one that focuses on moral issues and emphasizes the importance of slavery as the cause of the Civil War. It's a point of view that's vigorously disputed outside the academy, particularly by individuals who feel some affinity to the Confederate cause. But among professional historians, this emphasis on slavery has swept the field. It's a Whiggish interpretation, one that sets the Civil War within a broad trajectory of a country progressing to greater freedom. Lincoln, the Republican Party, and more generally the North are ennobled by this framework. To the extent that historians like James McPherson or Charles Dew, who espouse this point of view, discuss economics, they do so only to set the stage for the all-important moral issues. At most, they treat the economy as background and sketch it only with the broadest brush strokes, depicting a South dedicated to slavery and a North increasingly committed to free labor. Now, slavery, I should quickly add, gets involved in all interpretations. But for this idealistic school, the clash is not between two economic systems. Rather, it comes down to idealistic beliefs, deeply held convictions for and against slavery. But attractive as the idealistic interpretation might be, it is weakened by grave problems. First, it overlooks the Republicans' far-reaching economic goals and accomplishments. Some of these measures were presented in party platforms in the 1850s, and others were adopted soon after the Republicans took power in 1861. These initiatives included a national banking system, a uniform currency, higher tariffs, rivers and harbors improvements, a transcontinental railroad, and a Homestead Act. Second, when the events of these years are closely scrutinized, it's hard to see an attack on slavery or its defense as the central issue. Lincoln in the North did not take up arms with any intention of freeing the slaves. Just the opposite. Republicans swore when the war broke out they would not disturb the peculiar institution. Nor before the war did most Republicans show any interest in improving the lot of African Americans, either slave or free. Republicans, like most Northerners, condemned slavery, but the only anti-slavery measure they advocated was free soil, a policy that called for a West free from forced labor. And for many Republicans, as well as for other Northerners, free soil first and foremost reflected economic self-interest. It meant preserving the West for white Northern farmers. Third, the focus on slavery doesn't explain why for so many decades the North and South were able to compromise their differences. Finally, the idealistic approach doesn't explain the deep divisions within the sections. Of the 15 slave states, only 7 located in the Deep South left the Union before fighting broke out. And even within most of those 7 states, a large portion of the population, typically 40% or more, opposed immediate secession. The North was divided as well. In 1856, most Northerners backed the Republicans' opponents. And even in 1860, 45% of Northern voters favored a candidate other than Lincoln. All these problems with the prevailing interpretation, its inability to explain the economic program, the Republican reluctance to support emancipation, the existence of a long era of compromise, and divisions within the North and South argue the need for a new approach to the causes of the Civil War. It's against that backdrop that I developed my interpretation, which, as mentioned, argues that more than any other single factor, the evolution of the Northern and Southern economies explains why the sections came to blows. The book begins by looking at the era of compromises, which stretched from 1820 to mid-century. During this period, business activity brought together the North and South for 5 reasons. You see, I lecture to undergrads very often. First, trade along the Mississippi and its tributaries gave the Northwest and Southwest a shared outlook and a common set of interests. Second, the border states, which comprised the northern reaches of the slave regime, had strong and growing ties with the North. Third, the growth of textile manufacturing in New England and finance capital in New York linked the mill owners and the merchants of the North with the planters of the South. This alliance, complained Massachusetts Senator Charles Sumner, joined the Lords of the Lash with the Lords of the Loom. Fourth, the buoyant economy of the Southwest reinforced the case for union. The region boasted fresh soils and high returns, as well as a deep appreciation for the role the federal government played in pushing back native Spaniards and Mexicans. Finally, the burgeoning economy fostered similar divisions in every state, creating the foundation for 2 national parties. Throughout the United States, prosperous farmers, planters, and businessmen came together to support the Whigs. At the same time, urban workers and poorer farmers, individuals who felt excluded by the new exchanges, backed the Democrats. While the two parties battled each other vigorously over economic issues, both had adherents throughout the country and shared a common belief in a unified nation. These shared interests allowed the North and South to work through a series of divisive sectional problems between 1820 and 1850. These challenges and their resolutions included the Missouri Compromise, the nullification controversy, and the Compromise of 1850. However, by the late 1840s, the economies of both the North and South were evolving. These changes helped to end the era of compromise and to begin a decade of conflict that culminated in civil war. In the North, the most important development was the reorientation of trade from its north-south channel along the Mississippi to an east-west axis that included the Great Lakes and Erie Canal. To be sure, shipping along the Mississippi continued to grow, but commerce that went east-west by lake steamers and canal boats and after 1855 by railroads was far greater. A second development also transformed the North, the rise of anti-slavery. Although my work argues for the primacy of economic change in understanding sectional conflict, I don't ignore the growth of abolition and the anti-slavery movement. Any understanding of these years must take such crusaders into account. But the larger point is that abolitionists like William Lloyd Garrison remained a small minority and spoke for no more than 5% of the Northern population. In the mid-1850s, the Republican Party emerged based on these two overlapping constituencies. The individuals determined to develop the Northern economy and the supporters of militant anti-slavery. Both sets of goals, economic development and anti-slavery, shaped the Republican platform. But there is little question which was preeminent. The anti-slavery goals were limited. The Republicans rejected abolitionists. Indeed, they went out of their way to reassure the South they would not disturb its institutions. The Republicans also rejected radical demands for ending slavery in the District of Columbia, in federal shipyards, or for checking the interstate slave trade and repealing the fugitive slave law. Indeed, the only anti-slavery plank the Republicans pushed was free soil. And that program, as noted, thoroughly mixed principled and self-interested motives. More broadly, the ascent of the Republicans signaled that the era of compromise had ended. A purely Northern party, which shared little common ground with the South, and particularly with the Deep South, had risen to prominence. The South, too, was changing, but the pattern of change in the response to sectional issues was strikingly different in the Deep South, the border states, and the Upper South. We begin with the Deep South, the cotton states from South Carolina to Texas. These commonwealths, with their high levels of slaveholding and large plantations, led the resistance to the North. What changed their outlook in the 1840s was the stiffening Northern resistance to the expansion of slave territory and the increasingly urgent need of Southerners for new soils. Southerners needed new slave states to preserve the balance of power in the Senate, as well as Southerners increasingly had grown concerned about the dangers of soil exhaustion if they did not have new expanses to cultivate. Within the Deep South, the hardliners came from the more southerly counties. These were the areas where little grain was grown, where there were few overland links with the North, and where settlement came from the Atlantic coast and often originally from the south of England. Why then did the Lower South secede? Because the leaders in each of those states feared that with the victory of Lincoln and the Republicans and the party's firm opposition to expansion, their way of life rooted in slavery was doomed. You might ask whether this interpretation, which highlights the defense of slavery, isn't simply a restatement of the McPherson idealist approach. I'd answer only superficially. Rather, this economic interpretation grounds the Southern decision both temporally and geographically. Temporally, because it emphasizes the importance of the changes taking place after the late 1840s and the creation of this mindset, and geographically, because only one portion of the Deep South led the struggle, while citizens in the other counties resisted those demands. Secessionist fervor was much less apparent in the other two sections of the South, the border states and the Upper South. Indeed, the border states, Delaware, Maryland, Kentucky, and Missouri, would remain in the Union. If the entire South had been like the border states, or even the Upper South, there would have been neither secession nor civil war. What's clear is that the war was not brought on by the slaveholding states as a group, but rather by one set of self-interested individuals within the Deep South. The actions of the Republicans during the war and Reconstruction round out this interpretation, amply illustrating the nature of this dominant party. After the war, after April 1861, Republicans pursued, along with the preservation of the Union, two sets of goals: improving the lot of African Americans and strengthening the Northern economy. Again, there can be no question which priority was more important. Emancipation came only reluctantly, and in response to pressures from the exigencies of war, abolitionists, foreign governments, and particularly the actions of the slaves themselves. In contrast, the Republicans adopted a broad nationalist program, including a National Bank Act, income tax, a transcontinental railroad, a homestead act, and large outlays for rivers and harbors. During Reconstruction, Republicans moved very reluctantly beyond guarantees of narrow legal equality and soon backed away from the daring measures that Southern white recalcitrants forced them into. By contrast, programs to bolster Northern business continued apace. Thus, the outcome of the Civil War, with the blacks free but subjugated and big business flourishing and protected, was not an aberration. Rather, it was the logical outcome of the triumph of a party that had long been more devoted to the development of the North than to improving the condition of the less fortunate. To summarize, this talk, like my book, has argued that more than any other concern, the evolution of the Northern and Southern economies produced the Civil War. The dominant party, the Republicans, shaped the world we have today. It helped create an economically powerful country, but one in which many blacks remain second-class citizens. This retelling of the coming and aftermath of the Civil War is hardly fashionable. Americans, like the people of most nations, cherish their myths. They like to believe, for example, that the American Revolution pitted freedom-loving colonists against the tyrannical British. That's another book. They cherish the notion that the Civil War was all about freeing the slaves. But ultimately, myths are luxuries that no nation can afford. Economics, more than high moral concerns, produced the Civil War.
As early as the 1830s, as Bruce said, and it took a while for those arguments to prove salient. And again, we need all of these methods to come up with a holistic interpretation. Why they prove salient towards the end of our period has a lot to do with economics, surely. But I think that it's problematic in the 19th century, in which when people talk about economy, they talk about political economy, which sort of economy can best sustain a Republican moral and social and political order. It's problematic to separate these things out. I think absolutely slavery was the central concern, and that the sort of proximate cause of secession is, of course, Lincoln's election. And the important thing to observe there is that the notion that the Republicans weren't, in truth, as we can see all too clearly, weren't committed to racial egalitarianism, it was cold comfort to Southern slaveholders. For them, non-extension itself was a moral critique of slavery. If you believe that slavery was immoral enough not to permit its extension, then that was the opening wedge, slaveholders thought, to strangling the institution. And so I do think, as Bruce does, that slavery was at the core.
Okay. I think there's obviously a common ground, and as I said in the beginning of my talk and elsewhere, you can't explain the Civil War without explaining slavery. You can't explain secession without emphasizing that slaveholders were determined, the secessionists were determined to defend their institution. But having said that, then the question comes, why those particular slaveholders? In other words, you know, where I step back from these interpretations, my fellow panelists have suggested, is that secession wasn't simply carried through by the entire slaveholding class, that even within the Deep South, the divisions within the states, apart from South Carolina, where some of the slaveholders divided earlier, but not in the convention, but certainly as you move across the South, from Georgia, Alabama, Mississippi, Louisiana, Florida, slaveholders themselves divided. And in addition, earlier there's the first secession crisis, which occurs at mid-century when secession is discussed. And so the question is not, were some individuals, and can you get quotes from some individuals expressing their concerns about slavery, but why a particular group within the Deep South, and of course, slaveholders in the Upper South and border states did not, and why it was a particular group and why they behaved as they did when they did.
All right, I'll just say that I disagree with everybody else on the panel. I think one must distinguish between the causes of the secession and causes of the war, and certainly if my friend Bill Freeling were here, he would fault you all for ignoring contingent decisions during the secession crisis itself, and explaining the outbreak of war as opposed to secession. We cannot see a thing up here, so if you're, because of the light, so when you get to the microphone, can you please identify yourself and identify to whom you're addressing your question?
My name is Greg Downs, and primarily to Mr. Egnal. As somebody who studies the era right after the war, it has seemed to me with that in a sort of distance, that in fact, that on one point that you did is correct, that it has seemed to me that the discussion of the causes of the Civil War lacked energy recently, despite some very good individual works, because there was essential agreement. The fundamentalist triumph that you point to is a real triumph, and you find different ways of repeating it. And so I was very interested when your work started to come out, because it seemed to me that while I think the fundamentalist premise is right, that a Beardian revisionism might raise new points. The challenge I find both in your work and in the way you talk about it is I find myself unable to recognize your portrayal of the authors, that I find myself unable to recognize McPherson in the way you talk about McPherson, or Levine in the way that you talk about the premises of fundamentalism. It strikes me that it's almost unheard of to find a book now that argues an idealistic premise, but instead what they're arguing is an ideological premise. And that in fact one of the cliches, maybe a right cliche, but one of the cliches of modern fundamentalist arguments about the cause of the war is in fact exactly the notion that the Republican Party Party goes from union to emancipation. But there's this transition driven war. This is something that the fundamentalists have written in over and over and over and over again. And that, in fact, that the weight of the argument, therefore, largely settles upon the South. Why did the South secede? And so I'm interested in the idea that you're trying to get some energy going, and I'd be interested in the other panelists who've all written very smartly on the subject about how to re-engage broader debates. But I also feel that at some level we have to be a little fairer in our treatment of people who have written with subtlety about these issues.
Okay. Good question. First of all, I just had some additional material here. You started off saying you agree with one point I made, which is reassuring. I should mention, for those who want to pursue this, I've collected, a few of you might know this, but I've collected all the reviews, good and bad. This is a pleasant and very painful operation, on a website. So at www.clashofextremes.com, you can find pretty much everything. And people who are far less charitable than you are. I think that in terms of the explanation of McPherson, I somehow thought this question would come up. And I brought a recent interview of McPherson in which he says, and I'm quoting his words, where he said, and they decided the fate of, he talks about deciding the fate of the society, that the Southerners was completely in the hands of people who opposed the expansion of slavery, and whose leaders branded slavery a moral wrong that must eventually disappear from American society. So they seceded. And whether the question is moral or intellectual, the broad issue, and I think my fellow panelists in some ways bring this out. I mean, we're friends, I greatly respect their work, but I do differ, and I think that they can speak for themselves, but at least the way I heard it, and I took some notes, is that there was an emphasis on these issues, and certainly in Bruce's paper, on the moral question. So I think that the moral, the intellectual, I believe, blend into one another. And it's the whole idea of a South firmly committed to it, a North which is opposed to it. I don't know, this brief quote that I've read from McPherson, I think it's a fair statement, but others can pick up.
I would second Jim. I don't think it's a fair statement. I think that it's also misleading to cast the fundamentalists as Whig historians. I don't see it. The very same people who have done most to secure that fundamentalist consensus, McPherson and Foner, have also done the most to help us perceive how and why the retreat from Reconstruction takes place and to understand the long shadow that that retreat from Reconstruction casts over American history. I don't see this as a history that is about the easy moral triumph of the abolitionists. I think McPherson and Foner absolutely recognize the divisions within each society and have written very eloquently about those things. I think neither person nor Bruce nor myself sees these sections as monoliths in any way, shape, or form. My own book is about very much about, again, the sort of persistence of a cross-sectional anti-abolitionism that secessionists have to overcome. So I would second Jim's call for a kind of charity and generosity and humility in the way we characterize historiography.
Hi, my name is Tim Reary. This question is directed to Professor Egnal. With your focus on economics, would you be willing to agree with Charles Beard's famous dictum that you could write the whole history of the Civil War and never mention the word slavery? And would you also be willing to extend your interpretation to agree with Beard that the Civil War represented the eviction of one economic class, Southern planters, by another, Northern industrialists and capitalists? Thank you.
Okay, and short answer is no, I wouldn't agree with Beard. I mean, I think Beard's to be commended for raising issues of that sort, but I think of Beards as a creaky, mechanistic interpretation where there are very few people involved. The fine-grained analysis that's needed is not President Beard. It's more two large sections, and I don't think that holds up. I don't think that can be substantiated.
Hi, I'm Carl Weinberg. I edit the OAH magazine in history. I'm going to do a quick plug in the category of shameless self-promotion, but I think some of you may benefit. We are, two of our panelists are contributing articles to our upcoming issue coming out in a couple of weeks, which is on the origins of the Civil War. So if you're interested in reading more about this debate and being part of it, I just want to let you know that we'll be putting an issue out. It includes articles by Liz Varon and Marc, as well as John Earl, Paul Finkelman, Leah Vanderbilt, and teaching articles by Jim Lewin, Bruce Lash, Jim Prococo, and Jerry Kohler. And we hope that that people can use the magazine to continue and stimulate this conversation both on college campuses, high schools, public history sites, and so on. So I just wanted to bring that to people's attention. Thank you.
I'm Phil Magnus, George Mason University. I have a more general question for the panel. I wanted to ask your thoughts on how the immediate events of the secession Winter Congress fit within the framework of your respective thesis. For example, the failure of the Peace Conference, the Crittenden Compromise, the temporary success of the Corwin Amendment, some of the economic issues that came up in the Order of Secession.
Well, I think to me the most important fact about all of these last-ditch attempts to stem or turn back secession by coming up with yet another compromise is their failure, and thereby demonstrating that the era of compromise had collapsed, that in particular, the core of the Deep South had already given up on the Union and was not going to be lured back by any kind of halfway promises about their future. They fundamentally did not trust the northern population any longer, and from their point of view, I think they were quite right not to. I think that is what Lincoln's election showed, that the other side of this story, the collapse of these various compromise attempts, demonstrated how sure the majority of Northerners and the party whose presidential candidate they placed in office in 1860 was no longer prepared to back down from the platform of the Republican Party. And every one of the proposals put forward as a compromise measure essentially called upon the Republican Party to abandon its platform. The majority of the Republican Party, overwhelming majority of the Republican Party, refused to do so and recognized, on the other hand, that if it did do so, as Lincoln said, the South would be coming back to it over and over and over again, demanding further concessions on pain of beginning secession once again if the concessions were not made. It's a testament to the political polarization of the country that they failed.
I would only add that that final phase shows how important the sort of psychology of wounded pride is in understanding of those final failure of those final compromises. Trust had indeed been eroded, and it had been eroded in part because of a relentless fear-mongering by the South in particular, but to a certain degree by the North too. And I think the sort of most eloquent book on this subject is Charles Dew's Apostles of Disunion, which shows very, very clearly how the secessionists, Deep South secessionists, appealed to Upper South secessionists in those crucial months in which things hung in the balance, which side Virginia and these other key states would tilt to was very much up in the air. They appealed to them by invoking fears, dystopian fears of race war, race competition, and race mixing. And this invocation of fears echoes of the disunion talk that I've written about. Now, that dystopian vision of disunion was associated with subjugation to the Republicans, and secessionists were offering up the alternative of a glorious Confederacy. I would say only one more thing, and that's that my contribution that I've tried to make is to suggest that all these other factors are important, but at the end of the day, in order for there to be a war, in order for the two sides to mobilize their respective interests, each side has to be able to imagine a winnable civil war. For decades, Americans imagined an unwinnable civil war. When they thought of civil war, they couldn't talk about slavery without talking about civil war. When they conjured civil war, they conjured mutually assured destruction. And when the secessionists said that they were going to pledge themselves to disarm this Union of its terrors, they meant they had to imagine for their fellow Southerners a winnable civil war. And that set of contingencies in that last few months, the secession winter and spring, we see the secessionists sort of kick into high gear, use every argument and every political tactic at their disposal to press this image of a winnable civil war on their fellow Southerners.
I'd add on with this that I think the whole series, the whole efforts, and there were a series of compromises from Crittenden and Washington Conference, all of them took place after South Carolina had seceded, and none of them stood a chance of bringing back in the Deep South because the reasons were much deeper. What's also interesting is that all these secessionist commissioners, the ones that Charles Dew talks about as apostles of disunion, none of them were able to convince. They went to every single slave state, and they weren't able to convince any of the states outside of the Deep South. Secession came to the Upper South only when war broke out. And I think that what it reflects is that the reasons that people behave, both in the Deep South and the Upper South, reflected rather deep reasons, and that it wasn't simply rhetoric that was swaying them in either case.
If I can address your question maybe a bit more directly, if I'm allowed to mention a rival organization. My good friend Bill Cooper, in his presidential address to the Southern Historical Society last fall, which has been reprinted in the most current issue of the Journal of Southern History, argued, in fact, that the breakdown of those negotiations in Washington, when the Southerners announced at the end of December that it's all over, was primarily responsible for every state west of South Carolina seceding. So that it did have an impact. Not everybody would agree with him, but that's the west of South Carolina. It was that announcement at the end of December before any other state had left. That proved crucial. So those events in Washington did play in what was going on.
I'm Don Rogers. I teach at Central Connecticut State, Stanford Community College in Connecticut. I have a question for all the panelists. Professor Egnal began by remarking that the causes of the Civil War were really two-sided. Why did the South secede? Why did the North resist? And the panelists have largely treated the second part of the proposition is almost an automatic. And I'm wondering if they could explain or sharpen their explanation as to why the North did resist the Southern secession. Why did the North respond forcefully with unionism to Southern secession? Why did the Republican Party feel that it was necessary to keep the South in the Union to protect its economic program?
Okay. I'm not sure, but I think I'm the one who said that there were two questions to be answered. And I think the question leads to a point I've been itching to make, and I actually think Liz made once or twice as well. You cannot separate the question of morality from the question of economics and forms of society. Northerners, the northern majority believes that not simply in its economy, it believes in its form of society, which to be sure is inseparable from the way in which life is sustained. But that in turn gives rise to a whole constellation of values that these people, North and South, hold, though they happen, since they grow out of such divergently forming societies, to be very different values. When the South withdraws from the Union, the North responds, and not simply the Republican Party, that this is an attack on its rights, as it has consistently felt, that its rights, the rights of whites, are being endangered by this manner of defending slavery. Northerners overwhelmingly believe, and I think Liz is reminded of us of this, that the Union was the last citadel of the rights of free white men. And to start breaking this up and taking one section and after another out of it threatens the disintegration of the whole. If the whole dissolves, then there will be no source of strength for the protection of Republican rights in the North. And the fact that they weren't so far away from being right about this is demonstrated by what France does very promptly in Mexico. As soon as the North American Republic is divided, France moves right in on Mexico. And Northerners think quite rightly that if the North American Republic disintegrates, there's going to be a great deal more of that. What is left of the Union will break down further and further and further, and it will be prey. The whole country will be, the whole continent will be prey to the Europeans, that what's left of republicanism in the North will give way to anarchy and dictatorships. Caesar-like figures will arise out of the chaos, and this last best hope will be gone.
I'll just second that by saying that the Union represented for Northerners not just the state and the government and the nation, but it had a transcendent meaning as a unique Republican experiment, which they felt bound to uphold and defend the legacy of the American Revolution, the sacrifices of their forefathers, and so on. And the slave power conspiracy was perceived as a threat to that union, in part because the predominant image of the slave power conspiracy that had been elaborated by abolitionists and then Republicans was of a Southern society that was rapacious, that was on the move, that was not going to be satisfied stay within its boundaries and borders, but that had its eye on nothing less than the nationalization of slavery. And this sense of the slave power conspiracy as sort of constitutively aggressive and unwilling to rest satisfied with compromise, because it was in the nature of slavery, down to the slave household, down to the mode of discipline, the slave household, a kind of microcosm of slave society, it was in the nature of that society to violently press its claims and to run roughshod over freedoms. This was the perception of the slaveholding oligarchy in the eyes of Northerners. They also, I believe, certainly the Republican higher-ups believe, that under the heel of this slave power oligarchy was a latent, discontented, silent majority, if you will, of non-slaveholding yeomen who needed to be disenthralled from the heel of the domination of that slave power oligarchy. Republican Party certainly hoped that it could, through the normal political process, reach some of those non-slaveholding yeomen. As far as the Republican Party was concerned, when the South doesn't accept the results of the election and instead walks, it's repudiating the rules of the game, rules by which the Republicans might have made headway, might have accessed that silent majority. This is just, again, proof in the minds of Northerners that the slave power oligarchs don't play by the rules and are in their very nature aggressive.
Yes, sir.
I wonder if this is to Dr. Varon and Dr. Levine. Would you respond to what I think Dr. Engel said, that America after Reconstruction was not a deviation of the Republican efforts? Again, one more time. I think you said that America after Reconstruction was not a deviation of the Republican efforts before the war.
Yeah, I think the Republicans would have been very surprised to be told that, since, after all, what takes place after Reconstruction takes place because of the dismantling of Republican rule. The imposition of the Black Codes, the new version of the Black Codes, eventually the imposition of Jim Crow and so on, takes place only because the Republican domination of the federal government has been destroyed and the Democrats have been allowed to resume control at the state level and ultimately at the federal level. I think that's a pretty clear indication that post-Reconstruction America is something quite different from what the Republican Party had in mind, both in the antebellum era, but especially in the midst of the war and in the Reconstruction era, all of which are things that the Republican Party is attempting to implement, albeit at different stages of the process.
I'd comment that the Republicans don't lose control, certainly not of the federal government. There's only one Democratic president between Lincoln and Wilson, Cleveland, a very conservative Democrat. All the troops are pulled out under Republicans. The backing away occurs under Republicans, it occurs under Graham. And if you look at the individuals, and I'm particularly thinking of John Sherman, who is a pivotal figure, the way that history is understood, John Sherman is subordinated to people like Charles Sumner and some of the leaders who might have spoken out, the Garrison, but in terms of the Republican Party and the economic measures at the time, here's somebody who almost became Speaker of the House and continues through the war and after the war to shape policy, that the primary concern with the Republican Party is on economic development and all of the short-lived support, but short-lived support and the abandonment of the Republican regimes in the South. All of that happens under the congressional Republicans.
I think it's important to note that the backing away, the abandonment, the pushing away, the Republicans believe that they want a right to build their Southern coalition in the war. Why shouldn't they have? Right? They interpreted the war as a vindication of their free labor system, as an opening up of the South that had been closed to them by censorship and gag rules and mob violence. So they believed that they should have political access to that South so that they could build their coalition, and they began to build it. And they were attacked, the coalition was attacked and undermined from within by a systematic campaign of violence. So I don't think we should lose sight of how important that is. Let's try to imagine what might have happened in the absence of that violence. They could have built a coalition that could have pursued the very important economic aims that Marc has brought to the fore, and could have pursued it in an interracial democracy. That an economic agenda was not incompatible with interracial democracy. And I think the Republicans would have liked to have both if they could. But that proved very, very difficult because they were met with a violent backlash and counter campaign.
We've got about 7 minutes left of our allotted time, so maybe we can take questions from the three people in line and then adjourn, if that's all right. Yes, sir.
Thanks. Tim Roberts, Western Illinois University. I wanted to revisit Professor Holt's initial question about if the Civil War is the same thing as the secession crisis. I'm not sure that the panelists have convinced me of why Northerners prosecute the war at its beginning if slavery is morally repugnant and if the Northern economy is being integrated with the West over in the 1850s, as Professor Egnal suggests. We say, well, Northerners fear that if the South leaves, then the West might fragment. If the West fragments, New England fragments. But there's no real evidence that that's going to happen, right? There's no precedent for it. Moreover, the South's secession is not an attack on the central government, right? Secession is different from revolution. There's no, it's not 9/11. It's the South leaves, right? And why don't Northerners just say, go ahead, right? Let's integrate and build our free labor empire without having to worry about what to do with African Americans and about slavery.
It's a secession is a repudiation of the electoral process. And what's at stake is representative government and whether a representative government can survive. And again, American exceptionalism, the pervasive sense that the eyes of the world were still on this experiment, that there were foreign powers jealous of the U.S.'s rise, eager to enter the breach if a breach should open up. These are important things, but I think that to let the South go would be to admit the failure of representative government and of majority rule. And I'll say my colleague and my Gary Gallagher is coming out with a book on the power of this idea of union that I think will go a long way to addressing these sorts of questions.
Yeah, very quickly, I think Fort Sumter was 9/11. Firing on the flag. Really incensed Northerners, whatever they thought before them.
Yes?
Hi, my name is Alan. I'm a graduate student at Texas State. In discussing the causes of the Civil War, there's one main thing that I haven't heard discussed today, and that's states' rights. So I was wondering, in what ways did the concept of states' rights fit in with economic issues and slavery?
I think states' rights primarily functions as a suit of armor for Southern society against the attempt by anyone, including the federal government, to interfere with them. It has all sorts of other intellectual roots, but its vitality in the 1840s and the 1850s, the reason it has so much resonance is that it is seen as a way of protecting a given society. There's nothing, however, intrinsically and consistently localist about Southern politics, because the fugitive slave law demands that effectively the nullification of all sorts of state laws in the North and attempts to compel Northerners to do all sorts of things that they find violently distasteful. The attempt to impose slavery on the Kansas Territory, but obviously the locals, majority, don't want it, shows that how contingent, if you will, the support for states' rights is, and the demand that there be a federal code legalizing slavery throughout the territories does so as well. Just one last point, and that is toward the end of the Civil War, since we're invoking our books, I'll invoke my last one on the Confederate Emancipation. Towards the end of the Civil War, the South finally breaks down and starts talking about emancipating and arming slaves as a last-ditch way of preserving itself. And people start shouting, what the hell did we go to war for if not to protect our slaves? The central government says, what do you mean? We didn't go to war to protect our slaves. We went to war for the right to govern ourselves and states' rights. And they're basically laughed off the stage by the rest of the South, who effectively says what I said to begin with. States' rights was important to protect our central institution. How dare you now threaten to do so in the name of states' rights?
Yes, ma'am.
Sarah Poirier, assistant professor at Houston Baptist University. I'd like to address Dr. Egnal's question of why secession broke out first in the Deep South rather than the Upper South, in light of some of my studies of women writers and their families in the Upper South. Certainly, economically, slavery was much weaker in the Upper South, but it also seems to me that ideologically, there was much less attachment to slavery as a moral institution. It was more likely to be seen as a necessary evil, something that our ancestors forced upon us, alas. And at the same time, and perhaps Dr. Varon could address this, there's a very strong, perhaps stronger than other states in Virginia, a strong attachment still to the idea of union, to the point where, at least among the people I've studied, disunion is seen as inherently immoral and a recipe for chaos.
I think that's true. It's obviously a strong impulse in Virginia. Many Virginians sort of clung to this pro-slavery unionism, including some who would become very prominent leaders of the Confederacy. The turning point in Virginia, most everyone agrees, is Lincoln's call for troops, April 15th, a very important contingency in the wake of Sumter. this is a key moment for Virginians because Lincoln has seemingly now broken faith with moderates. Virginians who fancied themselves moderates were looking for signs that Lincoln was committed to a peace policy. Secessionists had been telling them he's not, trust us, he's intent on a policy of coercion. This April 15th call for truce seems to vindicate the secessionists and moves the key number of Virginians into the secession column. I would say just one other thing parenthetically about that, which gets back to the states' rights question. I think what Bruce said about states' rights is right on the money. But I would note that it's important maybe to separate states' rights from state allegiance. I think state allegiance was a powerful motivator for Southerners and for Northerners. The people fought for themselves as citizens of states. And I'll give Robert E. Lee as an example. He is a Unionist who, in his letters to his family during the secession winter, really invokes sort of disunionist, mutually assured destruction in the tradition that I've described, right up until Virginia itself secedes, and then famously he says, "Save and defense of my native state, I hope never to draw my sword again." He chooses the Confederacy, and he chooses the Confederacy not out of allegiance to states' rights. He has little patience for the constitutional arguments of the secessionists. He's a real Madisonian in that sense. But he does have a fierce sense of state allegiance, an idea that Virginia has a claim on him, 200 years older than the Union's claim, going back to the 17th century, that there is a kind of deep attachment, political and cultural attachment to his state. And I think that many other Southerners share this state allegiance. It was something that was tapped by the secessionists very candidly.
Just one other note in terms of understanding the motivation of the slaveholders in the upper south and the border states, Kentucky. And in Kentucky, it's a slaveholding state, the largest concentration certainly in the border states. And the Kentucky slaveholders are dedicated to slavery and they're loyal to the Union. And Kentucky has strong and growing ties with the North, economic ties. And so it comes back to, I mean, this whole question, did the South secede because of slavery? Well, yes, some of the people in the Deep South said so and were motivated that way, but there were slaveholders and there were slaveholders, and the ones in Kentucky, I mean, Lincoln had to deal with this during the first 12 months of the war, where one of the main reasons that he was reluctant to issue an Emancipation Proclamation was for fear of antagonizing loyal slaveholders. So it's not simply holding slaveholders. There are a lot of other aspects which have to do with your involvement in the national economy.
Our time is up. I want to thank you all for being an attentive audience, and I think we owe our